Excellent. Okay, let me just switch to you here. Okay, it's working. So, hi everyone. I'm going to talk about something I call Identities Exposed. So I will discuss authentication solutions, but not really from the point of security as we usually focus on, but rather from a privacy perspective. So I will show you a bit of some of the flaws that a couple of different solutions exhibit and how they could be used to expose identities of end users by malicious entities. So my name is David Johansson, for those of you who don't know me. I'm from Sweden originally. I've been living here in London for the last 3 years, working for a company called Digital, which recently got acquired by Synopsys. And I started working as a security consultant around 2007. First, I was quite focused on building secure solutions. I built identity providers, SAML 2 compliant providers, and secure logging solutions and similar. However, after a couple of years, or quite early, I started gravitating more towards looking at building secure solutions rather than just security solutions, because there's a difference between doing a security product and something that's actually secure. So I started looking into testing applications in terms of web security, looking at code reviews, threat modeling, and all those sorts of activities. So that's my main type of work that I do nowadays. So basically, it's about helping us to design and build secure software. So today, as I said, I'm going to talk about identities and authentication solutions. Really cares about privacy here? Some of you? Yeah, I guess most of you care about security. And for most of us, privacy is also quite important. So what if everyone knew who you were? In real life, many people are probably quite happy with that. I mean, after all, who doesn't want to be famous? What if everyone knows who we are when we walk around, right? That's fine. But in a digital world, you probably not want everyone to know who you are when you just browse around on the internet. What if everyone could know exactly who you were browsing around different pages or doing other things on the internet, right? So if we think about this, if we have our identities, like a passport, like here I have my passport from Sweden. So when I come here to England, I went to the border and then I had to show my passport to them, right? This is what I would do. However, I wouldn't walk around everywhere in the city with this one all the time like this. It would feel a little bit strange, maybe a little bit uncomfortable even. So most people would not want to do that. However, what's actually happened in some cases is that that's exactly what happened on the internet. As you visit different pages, and browse around, your identity could be revealed. So how could that happen? Well, if you look at a digital identity, it's very similar to our normal identities, like a passport. So if you look at a passport, it contains various information, like a serial number or a passport number, and that's similar to what we have in a digital certificate. We also have things that specify information about the subject, and we have information about what binds this identity document to the subject, so we can verify that it belongs to the bearer. We also have information regarding who has issued the certificate or the passport. So it's a trusted authority, something that we put our trust in and believe tell the truth. It also has some restrictions, like restrictions on validity period. So all of these things are very common between a digital certificate and our real identity documents, like passport. Apart from this, there's also another important thing is that we have some protection against forgery. So we're not supposed to be able to create our own document or to manipulate it. So it contains some things to prevent that from happening. So someone looking at your ID can actually detect it. In terms of the certificates, we have a signature on it. So it's signed by the issuer. And by validating that with the issuer's public key, you can verify that it's not been tampered with. So in Sweden, we have something we call the National Electronic IDs. And there are a couple of different systems for them. There are two major ones that dominate. And these are used for all types of online identification, typically for government e-services. For example, you can file your tax returns for logging in with this EID. You can apply for certain types of benefits. You can log into your online bank, and so on. So it's very useful both for authenticating and for signing. These certificates, just like the passport here, they contain personal identifiable information, like your full name. They also contain your date of birth. And they also contain something called a personal identity number, which is equivalent to national insurance number here in the UK, or social security number in the US. So they contain quite sensitive information. And in order to protect this, they use a special software. And this software protects these certificates. They're not stored just in the normal certificate store in Windows, for example, but they are protected by a specific software that requires you, for example, to provide a PIN code every time you use it in order to sign something or authenticate. So, what happened was that a couple of years ago, a lot of people, around 500,000, got a letter sent to them. My wife was one of them. And it urged the users to update their software. Really? Who sends a letter for that? What if Microsoft would send out letters with Royal Mail for every patch Tuesdays? How would that look? Has anyone got an email or a mail regarding updating your software? A physical letter? No, I guess not. So about 500,000 people actually got that. So why did it take such a drastic action? What was the problem? So it turns out that a couple of weeks before this, I was playing around a bit at work and discovered that in the software, it had a plug-in for browsers. So in a website, you could call this plug-in in order to request the user to authenticate or to sign a document. So that was really handy, and the user would need to provide a PIN code and so on to authorize that. But I also discovered that it contained another functionality called a NUM certificate. So that's quite interesting, because here I could actually enumerate certificates on the client. And what happened was is that when you call this on this plugin, it will give you the certificates that contained on that user's machine. So in other words, their electronic identity. The thing here was that the user did not have to log into your site first in order to invoke this. And the user did not get any prompt, because you don't need the PIN code just to read a public certificate. The PIN code is used to protect the private key. So any site that the user visited could request their identity by just invoking a few lines of JavaScript. And even if you were using proxies to hide your IP, or even if you're using like a Tor network or similar, as long as the website could run JavaScript within your browser and you had this electronic ID with a plugin installed, your identity would be revealed. So here it was not only actually 500,000 users exposed that got this letter, but there were also many customers and enterprise that use this at the workplace, for example, for smart card authentication. And this plugin was also used for that. So it was another 500,000 users. So in total, we had about 1 million users' identity. They could be exposed to any website that they visited. So that's why it took such a drastic action to send out this letter and urge them to update, because there was also another issue. You couldn't send an automatic update to this software. They had to manually download a new version and install that. So that's something to keep in mind if you're planning to distribute software and how you deliver security updates. So we could write this off as a one-time event. I mean, could be just a software error. This provider, they were perhaps not good at security. And honestly, I would tell it, they were quite good in security. They were not as good in privacy. When I contacted them, they were really quick to fix this. So within a week, they had actually a new version that was tested on different clients and had fixed this very quick. However, distributing this to clients took a lot more effort. So is this just a one-time event? Well, it may be tempting to write it off as such, but unfortunately, I believe there's a bigger problem. I think actually, in general, we have a problem with privacy in many authentication solutions. And the reason for that is I believe we have focused very much on security of authentication solutions, but not so much on privacy. So in order to fix that, what can we do? Well, what I recommend is to try to think about privacy whenever you create a security solution for authenticating users. And I believe that we need to have some privacy requirements capture this. So what I've tried to do is to create a couple of user stories. So I have four user stories relating to privacy. Before that, look at what we normally try to consider when we look at authentication solutions. We focus on all of these security aspects like password policies, multi-factor authentication, protect passwords in parentheses and at rest. A lot of talks about which hashing algorithm is best, bcrypt versus scrypt versus pkmedef2, and all of these things. Well, that's really good to do, but does it really protect end users' privacy in these solutions? Well, I would argue that it doesn't, not necessarily. So what we need is a couple of user stories to capture these requirements. So the first one of this is, as a user, I want to know who I communicate with before I authenticate myself. And it's to know that I don't want to reveal my identity to some unknown user or some unknown system that I don't intend to reveal my identity to. So that's why I need to know who I'm communicating with first. So just like with a passport, I'm having this one right. So the reason why I show it when I come to the border is because I know I'm going through a border control. I see that the person is someone authorized to do that. They're sitting in their booth and so on. So I go then and I show them my passport. But I wouldn't just do that to anyone on the street if I was walking home now and they show me your passport. And why would I do that? I don't want to show you my passport, my identity, my details, right? So we want to know who we actually communicate with. The next thing is that as a user, I also want to know when I authenticate. Just because I visited an entity before and logged in on that site does not necessarily mean I want to log in the next time. At least I want to know if an authentication happens. It shouldn't happen without my knowledge. And also, I want to know and control what type of information I expose to the other entity when I authenticate myself. And that is to make sure that I only reveal information about myself that I intend to reveal to the other party. And as a user, I also want to know that only the intended recipient can actually see the authentication data I choose to share with the server authenticator. And that is to make sure that no one, an authorized party that's listening in on that conversation, for example, a passive network-based attacker, is able to read the information that I sent. So what we have here are four user stories relating to end users' privacy, and we can then translate into what are called privacy requirements. So the first one is that we need to make sure that the system authenticates for the user. The second and third one is about having some explicit or implicit approval of when I authenticate and what information I share. And the last one would be to make sure that we have a secure transmission of these authentication data. And if you identify more things, perhaps I forgot an important aspect here. If you have things you would like to add to this, come talk to me after today, and I will be happy to add that to the talk and to my list here. But I think these capture some of the most important aspects as an end user, what I want to maintain in terms of my privacy during authentication. So, let's try to look at another system then. So, how many of you are familiar with TLS? I guess most of you are using HTTPS. You know, TLS is the layer under it that secures communication. So it provides an encrypted tunnel, and it also authenticates the endpoint that we communicate with. So with TLS, apart from authenticating the server we connect to, we can also authenticate the client. So when we set up the connection, the server can request the client to provide a client certificate in order to authenticate itself, just like the server does with its certificate. So looking at this, are the privacy requirements I mentioned here, are they fulfilled in mutual authentication with SSL or TLS? Well, I would say no. And we're going to look at a couple of examples. So the first thing I'm going to do here is now to try to show this live demo. Hopefully the demo gods are not against me, so we'll see how it goes. So I'm going to start looking at one type of issue, which is a browser, we'll say. So we're going to look at Internet Explorer and Chrome and how they differ in terms of handling validation of server certificates and client authentication. Let me just look into this one. So what I have here is a Ubuntu server where I've set up OpenSSL. So what I'm doing here is that I'm pretending that this server is someone with access to the network between the end users and the target systems. So someone on with a privileged network position. So what you can do on a privileged network position is that you can intercept communication. You can look at the communication, right? So anything we send in plain text HTTP can be eavesdropped on. And that's why we need HTTPS to make sure we communicate with the right entity and make sure the communication is protected from insight by no first parties and also from modification. Okay? So what I'm simulating here is that I'm setting up a server to be a fake server. So I'm trying to impersonate example.com in this case. So I've created my own key and my own certificate. So if we go back here, we see that what I've done here to simulate the traffic will go through this privileged network position is that I've done a shortcut. I've simply just added IP address for example.com in my host file. So in the browser now, hopefully when I try to access this page on example.com, it should go towards my attacker system instead. So let's try to open Internet Explorer. So let's type in the address here. So if I go now to example.com, we see that we get this warning, right? So that's really good because that's what we should have. I'm not trusting the certificate that was issued for this fake site because someone has intercepted the communication, they're pretending to be example.com and a person like that. But because the browser can actually validate the certificate, it can see that this is a certificate issued by an untrusted authority and it will give the user a warning. So you would never click continue on this, right? Many have done that. I mean, I heard from Google that had some research many years ago regarding their warnings in the browsers. And they found that unfortunately, when they warned users about malicious web pages they were about to visit, about half of those, 50%, would actually click through those warnings. So, I mean, with these certificate warnings, I'm not too convinced that everybody would stop there. Some might actually click through. But let's say that we are good, well-educated, security-wise users, so we won't click through here. So, okay, we stop there. We won't go to this site. Now, let's change this a bit. Let's say that this company, example.com here, which is an example company here, but let's say it was a real company that actually wanted to authenticate their users. So let's say I was a user here. And instead of using just username and password, we want something stronger. So why not use TLS client certificate authentication? So perhaps they had issued certificates to their users, and the users would then use these certificates to authenticate to the system. So let's try to simulate that. So going back to Ubuntu, I will close this, and I will set up this a bit differently. So what I do now is that I add the verify option. And what it will do is, what that will do is that it will now request a client certificate. Okay? So what if this fake site now is requesting client certificate from me? Let's go below this one. What we see here, that's actually, it's requesting my client certificate. But why is it doing that? It wasn't even the real site. So here we have something requesting the client certificate, and at this point, I actually don't have any knowledge of this site being a real one or not. So we can see the warning in the background, but let me do this better. So if I close this one, let me move out of the VM. Let's go to a new one. And here we can see we don't have any warning, and I go here, and we see that we're going to example.com, we see HTTPS in the address bar, and I get the request for the client certificate. Okay, everything seems fine. I usually log into this page. I usually use my client certificate. So that's all good. There's nothing telling me here that there's anything wrong with this system I'm going to. So let's click OK there. What's happening now is that suddenly I get a warning. And in the background you can see the console of the fake server, that it did the connection, but then it was shutting it down. So the browser will first actually request the client certificate, and then it will show the warning to the user and shut down the connection. So although we got requested for a client certificate, it didn't send any data to the server. It just shut down the connection. So that's still fine. Safari is actually the only browser I've tried that will warn you the first time. All the other browsers will show you the prompt for a client certificate. But let's try another browser. So what if we start with Chrome here? And I now go to example domain. Again, we see that it will also ask me for my client certificate. And again, we see that there's no warning. There's nothing telling me that there's anything wrong with the site I'm going to. Excuse me. So let's say we go to this site, and oh, now we get a warning. So it now tells me there's something wrong with this. So it says my connection is not private, and it also says, if you're looking at the tab here, up here, can you see what it says? It says a privacy error. So there's something wrong with the privacy of this connection. So there's not only something wrong with the privacy of this connection, but if you go to Ubuntu, we'll see there's also something wrong with the privacy in Chrome. Because what it actually did here was to send my client certificate to the server that was a fake server before it warned me that it was not the right one. So although I didn't click continue when I got the warning, my identity has already been revealed to this. So an attacker could set up a system with a fake certificate, try to lure users to go to that site and request a client certificate from them. Users that normally would go to that type of site, perhaps automatically send their certificate, would reveal their identity to an unknown entity. So that's obviously not so good. So, going back to the presentation, let's look at what actually happened here. Excuse me. What happened here is that the client first sends a client hello message when you are trying to initiate a TLS session. So in the handshake, we send the client hello, and the server will then respond back with server hello and with some other things. For example, its certificate to prove its identity, and in this case, I was also sending a client certificate request. So what happens then is that here I have a forced or not valid certificate. So the certificate I send to the client in this case was generated by myself in OpenSSL. So it was not issued by a trusted root authority. However, the browser doesn't give you any warning about that. It just prompts you for the client certificate. So what happens then here is that the client actually sends a certificate to the server. And only after that, when we finish this, the browser will then tell me about this issue. However, at this point, it's already too late because my identity has been revealed to this other party that I probably didn't want to reveal my identity to because it's something I don't trust. So this is obviously not too good. So if we look at this first round, it looks like Microsoft had an edge over Chrome here. So 1-0 to them. So does that mean Microsoft are better than Chrome? Well, that would be a bit too fast to conclude. I mean, first of all, Internet Explorer actually used to do the exact same thing. So when I started looking into this and the browser found something, it was actually on Internet Explorer. And then I realized the same applied to Chrome. And now when I tried it again, I realized it doesn't work anymore on Explorer. So it only affects Chrome. So should Chrome fix this? Well, probably. I mean, they could check the client, the server certificate before they send the client certificate. That's a reasonable thing to ask of them. But it wouldn't really make any difference because this is not a browser issue per se. It's an issue with the TLS protocol. So there is a flaw I will show you that affects all browsers. So it will affect Explorer, it will affect Safari, it affects Firefox, and more or less any browser or any TLS client. Because if we look at this handshake again, first the client sends the hello, the server responds back with certificate and the client certificate request. The client then sends certificate, some key change material, the certificate verify message which contains a signature with the client's private key to prove its identity or possession of the private key corresponding to the certificate sent, and then the finished message. So when we look at this a bit closer, the server authenticates itself with a certificate, right? That's how TLS works. But how does the client actually validate this certificate? Any suggestions? How do you validate a certificate?
Certificate of authority.
Sorry?
Look at the chain.
Yeah, you look at the certificate chain. Yeah? So you need to check that it's changed up to trusted root authority. Anything more? Is that enough?
It's signature.
Yeah, you need to check the signature. You need to make sure that it hasn't been tampered with. If I could tamper with the certificate, I could change the chain and say it was signed by an authority it wasn't signed by. So we need to check that as well. Anything more?
Revocation list.
Revocation list? Yeah. Actually, browsers, they're not really doing a good job there. Most of them, they fail open. I think, if I remember right, Chrome had evenly stopped doing it completely. So certificate revocation in terms of service certificates is not really a thing. But there's more things, yeah?
Check the certificate is for the right domain name.
Yeah, it needs to be for the right domain name. Yeah, so we checked the DNS, so if I typed in www.example.com here, I want to make sure the certificate common name or subject alternative name matches that, right? Because otherwise, if I own attacker.com and then use that to impersonate example.com, it can still be signed by a valid root authority that I trust, but it's for the wrong entity. So we need to check that as well. So all of that is good and all of that is done by the browsers. But there's one thing here that I actually can't do. That's very important. So what if I go to, instead of sending my fake certificate here, I go to example.com on port 443. So I will initiate a TLS connection with them. And I will get their public certificate, right? Because it's public, anyone can get it. So you can always get public certificates on the site. So what if I now use this public certificate to send that back to the client? It will be for the right domain, it will be by trusted authority, and it will be not tampered with because I don't change anything in it. So what would prevent me from doing this?
DNSSEC.
Perhaps, yeah, so it would prevent you from the traffic itself. So it's more about the binding of the domain name to the IP. But let's say that the user got to this fake server, so to say, so they can control the route of the traffic.
Would the response be signed, be encrypted to that public key? So only the private key of the realexample.com could decrypt the response?
Yeah, that's how it should be. So what we need to do here is we need to verify that the server also has possession of the private key corresponding to this. Because otherwise, it's the same as having this passport, and I would give it to Sam, and then you would go and enter UK. And when you do that, and they show you this passport, what would they do?
Check the picture.
Yeah, they would probably check the picture and see that's really? Maybe not. Maybe they would do some more tests and see that I don't really look like this one, this passport belongs to you. And that's exactly what the private key is here for. We want to make sure that the system showing this certificate actually owns the private key.
What about rogue CAs, though? You've got someone that has created a certificate, for example, .com, but actually doesn't own a similar thing.
Yeah, in that case, you can't do much. In that case, you would need other things like certificate pinning and so on. And it's a bit of a different story, but in this case, let's assume that the PKI works. We all know that it has its flaws and it's kind of broken in a sense. But let's assume the PKI works and I only cross certain root authorities and they're all good and no rogue certificates. So in that case, what would happen here is that in many key exchanges, specifically key exchanges using a static RSA key exchange, what happens is that the server sends its public key, the client will then encrypt a pre-master secret. So it encrypts some key material that we'll use to derive the session key used for the symmetric encryption that underlies the TLS connection later on. It will encrypt that with the service public key. So if I don't have the public key, I cannot decrypt and get the right key material. So when I try to then encrypt something, we won't talk the same because we'll have different key material. However, if you look here, before we start to encrypt, we change the cipherspec and start encrypting communication, the client has already sent its certificate. So here is where the type of ciphers that is used is important, because you're probably aware of forward secrecy or perfect forward secrecy. You heard about ephemeral keys and so on. And if we're using that, you can't do this because you will also send key material that binds it to the public certificate. But if you don't do that, there will be no explicit validation of the server's possession of the private key. It will only be an implicit validation in terms of the server being able to decrypt the traffic being sent from the client to server. So how can we now exploit this? Well, as I said, as a rogue server, I could download these certificates. And then I could make sure that we use a cipher suite that doesn't require this extra key material. So I make sure to use something using a static RSA key exchange. And the client will send its list of supported ciphers, and it's the server that is choosing which one to use. So as an attacker on the server, I can control this. So of course, as an attacker, I would choose something like TLS RSA with AS, 128.256. And this will use the server's public key only to encrypt on the client a pre-mod secret, but I will not sign anything with a private key during the handshake. So what happens here is that I can identify myself with the real certificate. I've not authenticated towards the client yet. Authentication happens when they verify the possession of the private key. That's further down here. But at this point, I've only identified myself. And at this point, the client can't do anything to validate that claim. There's nothing the client can do to say if it's true or not. Even if you use certificate pinning, there will be no difference, because it will be the actual real certificates that the client would expect. So the client will then happily send the certificate if requested. And only later we will see that the TLS connection will fail, because we will have different keys, so we won't succeed in setting it up. But at this point, as an attacker, to reveal the identity of the user, I've already achieved the goal, because the client certificate has been sent. So let's try to do that as well and see if the demo works. So if I go back here to my server, so let's close that one. I think I prepared it before. So what I will do now, I'll start it a bit differently. So what you will see here is that what I've done, I've gone to the realexample.com, downloaded that public certificate, which you can do through the browser. That means it's very simple. And I'm using that as the certificate here. And as the key, I'm using still my forged key, my own key that I have. So I don't have the real private key for the certificate, but I will still start OpenSSL with a mismatch in terms of the public certificate and private key. If you try this at home now, it won't work for you, because OpenSSL will actually check that. So I had to modify OpenSSL slightly to bypass that, but it's very easy to do. So another thing you might notice here is that I specify the ciphers. So by doing that, I limit it to the ciphers supported by all modern browsers that only use static RSA key exchange. So as an attacker, I control the key exchange, and I know that the client won't have any ability to verify my claim of identity. So let's try this again now. So remember, we got the certificate error before, but it didn't send any information from Internet Explorer. So I close that one. So, now we go to this again. I get the question about the client certificates, and I click OK. What it says now is that you're not connected to a network. So Explorer doesn't really tell you the truth all the time. It tells you something more fancy, because it doesn't believe that you will understand technical details. So it just pretends that you are not really connected to the internet. What actually happened here is that it fails to set up a TLS connection. But if you look on my Tiger server here, I actually got now the certificate. So we see here, I got the name, contained the email address. Depending on the organization and what type of information you store in the certificate, it could be quite a lot of information, like your phone number perhaps, maybe other information, could be some roles that you have. And depending on the situation, it may be different things. But the identity of the end user here is revealed. And as an user, I have no way of telling when I'm connecting to the right server or the wrong server. So let's try from another browser. So if we try the same now in Chrome, just restart it, make sure. Let's go to example domain again. And before I do that, let's go here and just space out a bit, so you see I'm not cheating. Problem here actually tells me a bit more, so it tells me that something wrong with this connection. We can see here that we get a bad MAC alert here on the record. So it fails to set up the connection, but as we see here, it sends the details to the server. Okay, so let's move on a bit more here. Let's try another browser. So let's try with Firefox. Again, Firefox will ask me about certificate. And also note that we can click to remember this selection. So in many browsers, what you can do is you can configure it to automatically submit a certificate. So if it only has one match, or if you visited before, it will always send that, even without this prompt. And when I tried it before, Safari, it will automatically send a certificate once you've chosen it for a certain site, a certain domain. It will remember that and automatically send it the next time you visit. So let's see, say we remember this, we click OK, and we now see that we got something wrong, but again here, the certificate, client certificate is sent to the server, so our identity is revealed. So this is not just these browsers that have something wrong, this is something that's a flaw in the protocol itself. So any TLS client you have, and this includes the latest version TLS 1.2, will be vulnerable to this. So this is obviously something to keep in mind if you're using client authentication, and especially be aware of if you're using any personal identifiable information in these client certificates. So how can an attacker exploit this? Well, I will show you what you could do in this case. What you could do as an active attacker, if you want to know the identities of users, is that you could try to inject requests to such a server. So even if users are not actively trying to authenticate to a server and you intercept that request, even if you're just browsing a normal web page like going to bbc.com.co.uk or something with plain text HTTP, as an attacker, I can intercept that request, right? I can modify the response in the plain text that I inject, for example, an invisible iframe that will then be loaded in the browser. That will point to my attacker site on HTTPS. And the attacker site will then request a client certificate. The browser will either prompt the user to supply it, or even perhaps silently send your identity without the user knowing, if you have configured your browser to do that, or visited that domain before. And there will be no warning in the browser about something being wrong here. So that's what you can do as an active attack. In terms of other attacks, which is more well known, I guess, is passive eavesdropping on this. So if we look again at the TLS handshake here, we see that there's quite a lot of exchanges going back and forth, but the encryption here happens first after we have sent this from the client to change the cipher specification. So from here we have ciphertext, but here we have plain text. So anyone listening in on the network can actually read the client certificate as it's sent from the client. So we both have active attacks and passive attacks targeting TLS client authentication. So going back to the privacy requirements I mentioned before, let's see how well it did. Well, as you probably see, it's not very good at all. So first of all, we've identified here that the client cannot verify the identity of the server before it reveals its own identity. So the server does not authenticate first. When it comes to explicit approval of authentication, in many cases, depending on the browser, it will prompt you for a certificate. But at that point, you don't know who you are authenticating against. And also, in some browsers, you can configure it to automatically supply this client certificate. So it could well be that you're never aware of authentication, or sorry, the revelation of your identity takes place. And finally, we also have explicit approval of identity data to share. We don't have that because whatever is in the certificate will always be sent all at once. You can't pick and choose what information you send. Anything that's stored within your client certificate will be revealed to the other entity. And also in terms of secure transmission, we know that the certificate is sent before the channel is encrypted. So anyone can eavesdrop on that communication and passively get the information stored in that certificate. So in terms of privacy, client certificate authentication is not really good. It's really good in terms of security, and it's usually much stronger, or it is much stronger than password authentication. But in terms of privacy, it's not such a good thing. So you need to be very careful how you implement and handle this. Excuse me. So what can we do about this? Well, the good news is that TLS 1.3 has some really, really good improvements. So if you follow this, you know there's quite a lot of changes to how TLS works in the new version. So they've taken away a lot of things that were not so good in the old versions. They've simplified it. It's much quicker. Two of the really good things in terms of the privacy here is that, first of all, whenever the server authenticates with a certificate, it always has to provide a certificate verify message, which is a signature of the full handshake so far. And that enables the client to validate that the server possesses the private key corresponding to that certificate. So we won't have this issue with the static RSA key exchange that we have in TLS 1.2 and earlier. The other thing that happens is that the client will start to encrypt the communication much earlier in the handshake process. So only the very first few interactions are unencrypted, but before you send the client certificate, the communication will be encrypted. So in terms of passive eavesdropping, that issue will also be gone once we have TLS 1.3. At least if they do it according to the current draft. The problem then is that it's still work in progress. So there's not many implementations supporting this yet, and I guess we'll probably a couple of years before we see widespread use and support of TLS 1.3. So for now, what we can do is simply not so much else than avoid storing personal identifiable information in our client certificates. So I was going to talk about SAML a bit as well. But let's do this quickly. We don't have much time, so I'll do just a short, and then we'll take some time for questions. So as I mentioned before, I also worked quite a lot with SAML earlier in the days. And it also has some types of privacy issues. So let's look at how it works when we're using SAML web browser SSO. What happens here is that as a user, I can first go to an app and want to use a resource. So if I'm not authenticated, that app can now redirect me to an identity provider. So if I go from web app 1 and first be redirected to an identity provider, I haven't authenticated yet, so it will challenge me for some credentials. And that may be any type of authentication mechanism. It could be a password, it could be a client certificate again, we just discussed. It could be some other form of token. But we authenticate with some means. Once we've done that, the identity provider may set up an authenticated session with me. So from my browser to the IDP, I now have an authenticated session. And then the IDP will also create a SAML assertion, which is kind of a token that contains information about me as a user and asserts my identity towards the web application. So now I can access the resources I want on web application 1, and I now have an authenticated session with that one too. Then when I go to another website that relies on the same identity provider, I don't need to provide my credentials again. So what happens here is that I will be redirected to the identity provider, but it will see that I already have an existing session with it. So it can automatically generate a new SAML session for me, and then I automatically get logged into website 2. Single sign-on, very convenient, very good, very efficient for end users. You don't need to type your passwords each time. You don't need to have several different accounts in different systems. You only have one set of credentials, which you can access many systems with seamlessly. So that's very good. When we operate within one organization, so for example, at a bank or at another type of operation, we may have one IDP and all our applications that we use with that IDP are within the same trust zone, say. And within our organization, we have probably a very good level of trust in all applications, and we may have controls in place to prevent any application from being malicious. So I'm not really concerned with revealing my identity to any of these applications. Single sign-on works really great in this scenario. However, if we start to federate identities across organizations, so if I have several different organizations where we have different applications that share a common identity provider, I may trust this identity provider. I may trust a certain application. But do I trust the other application from another organization? What if that one turns malicious? What if that one wants to know my identity without my knowledge? If I don't intend to authenticate when I go there, but I just want to visit the website, could there be any risk? Well, if we go back to this again, we see that here, what the malicious app could do is, instead of sending a normal authentication request to the IDP, it can set a specific flag called is passive to true. So when that happens, the server, the IDP in this case, is not allowed to inform the user of any authentication. So it should not make any visible change or prompt the user for any information or confirmation according to the specification. So if the IDP is following the specification as written, it will silently create a new assertion for me as a user and provide that to this other service, which I may never be aware of. So although I didn't authenticate to that, if that service has a trust relationship with an IDP where I have an identity, an existing session, that service could get knowledge of my identity. So the privacy requirement in terms of knowing when I authenticate and make sure excuse me, that I only reveal my identity to parties I want to do it, is not met, so it's not fulfilled. So just to summarize this, what we've seen here is that users' privacy is often neglected in authentication solutions. I think we've focused quite a lot of resources on security, for good reasons, and we've done quite a good job there in many solutions. However, many of these solutions that have flaws in terms of privacy, and I believe the reason for that is we haven't really thought of these privacy user stories. We haven't specified our privacy requirements. So what I really want to recommend you and encourage you to do here is actually think about your users' privacy. Think about how they're using your system, how they authenticate, and and make sure that you design your solutions in a way that protects their privacy. Okay, any questions?
Right. Thanks very much, David. Absolutely fascinating talk. Any questions?
If we go back to the SAM and the second one, the second background.
Sorry, you want to go back to the SAM one?
SAM,
this one? Yes?
I really did not understand how, if I am already authenticated, so what does it mean with identity exposure?
Okay, yes.
It's authentication.
Yes, good question. So let me clarify. So here we have one web app. As a user, I want to go to web app, the first one, and I authenticate. I intend to do that. It's an application I normally use. I have an account, and I want to authenticate. So I don't have any concerns with revealing my identity. It's my choice. What happens here is if I now have done that, through the IDP, I've set up an authenticate session with this identity provider. If I then, as a user, go visit another website, maybe from another organization, that I don't intend to reveal my identity to, but if that website has a trust relationship with this identity provider and can send an authentication request to it, it can request my identity without my knowledge and setting the passive flag to true, which means that the IDP is not allowed to inform me of the authentication event. And because I already have an authenticate session with the IDP, it will send my identity data to this malicious app.
So even if I'm accessing the public URL from that application tool?
Yes, if you just go to any URL on it, it can, in its response, it can include, for example, like a hidden iframe or something pointing to make an authentication request in the background to the server, get your identity anymore now. Yes?
So is the issue here that there's identity providers that are being too liberal with exchanging metadata with other service providers? Because So the experience I have with SAM was the shibboleth.
Yeah.
So if you want to create a relationship between a service provider and an identity provider,
you
have to, as a service provider, provide metadata to the IDP.
Yeah.
So you have, so this malicious web app would already have to be trusted by the IDP.
Yes.
So it's the issue that here that there's IDPs that are creating too many of these trust relationships.
Yes, so my point here is that what if when we have a common identity provider for several different applications, perhaps from different organizations, as an end user, I may trust certain of them, I may want to log into them, I trust the IDP, but there may be other applications which I don't intend to reveal my identity to, but if they have a trust relationship with the IDP, they can turn malicious and they can maliciously request my identity without my knowledge.
Okay, got it, thanks.
So yeah, you're right that it requires this preset of a trust relationship, because normally the identity provider will only serve authentication requests from systems that it has a previous established relationship with. Right. Any other questions? Okay. If you have any more questions, feel free to reach out to me. I'll be around, as I said, as well. I tend to release a white paper, most of it is written, I just need to do some minor updates.
Just a reminder guys, we will have a break. During the break you can talk to David,
yeah.
And that
yes.
Break will be applied. So thanks.
Okay.
Thanks David.
Thank
you. So Dennis is a bit of a legend.